The man grabbed the excrement on the ground and observed it carefully. Suddenly, he seemed to have discovered something. Then he smeared the excrement on his face and ordered everyone to smear it all over their bodies. They lay on the ground and moved forward slowly. This was a hunt 20,000 years ago, and the target was the yak in front of them. Suddenly, three ants lay on the man's hand, and he swallowed them without even looking at them. They haven't eaten for too long. The leader gave an order, and everyone roared and rushed towards the yaks. Not to be outdone, the yaks also rushed towards them. On one side were the ferocious humans and on the other were the crazy cattle. Seeing that the two sides were getting closer and closer, the opportunity finally came. The fence made of spears blocked the way of the yaks. The yaks that had lost their direction instinctively turned around and rushed towards the cliff. For a time, the yak herd was in chaos, and hundreds of yaks fell off the cliff. Suddenly, a yak reacted and began to launch a counterattack, rushing straight towards Koda, the son of the tribal leader. Seeing the menacing yak, Kodak's eyes were filled with fear as he was turned upside down by the inexperienced yak. The yak attacked again, and Kodak was hung on the horns and rushed towards the cliff. The father threw the spear in his hand with all his strength. Instead of stopping, the angry yak ran faster and faster. The yak came to the edge of the cliff and knocked Kodak off. By the time the tribesmen rushed to the edge of the cliff, it was too late. Kodak was hanging on the cliff with one hand and might fall at any time. His father yelled at him not to let go, but the stone in his hand suddenly broke. He fell rapidly and fell heavily on a rock. Seeing Kodak so close yet so far away, his father was extremely anxious. He jumped down to rescue regardless of the danger. The tribesmen on the side grabbed her, and she told the man, "Your son is dead, but nothing can happen to you. As the leader of the tribe, you have to take us home." Then, the patriarchs began to collect prey, and the father kept calling his son on the edge of the cliff until dark, but there was no response. It appears that the boy is indeed dead. The next day, my father set up a tombstone with a stone, endured the grief and turned around to leave. Although his son is gone, the clan still needs his protection. Not long after his father left, he was spotted by a vulture looking for food. Kodak was not dead yet, and there was an abyss beneath him. In despair, he called for his father, and his leg was also broken. The desire to survive occupied his entire brain, and he tried to climb down. Suddenly, his foot slipped and he lost his balance instantly. He could only cling to the cliff with his hands. He was hanging on the mountainside, unable to move. Once he let go, he would be shattered to pieces. But at this time, there was a heavy rain in the sky, and the heavy rain gathered into a river below. Kodak's physical strength reached the limit. Looking at the unknown depth of rain below, he might still have hope of survival if he jumped. Kodak decided to take the risk. I don't know how long it took, but he miraculously survived again, and the injury on his foot became even more serious. Thirsty, he crawled to a pool and drank some dirty water. Then he took off his shoes, and his swollen feet looked like pig's trotters. He found a few stones, placed his feet in the middle, endured the severe pain, and moved the bones with all his strength. He made another simple fixed brace, and now he can finally walk. He dragged his tired body towards the top of the mountain. When he came up, there was no one there, only the tombstone his father left for him. He was really desperate at this moment. How could he go home without his father? But at this moment, several more wolf howls were heard not far away, and he was instantly frightened to death. He hurriedly started to run away, with the wolves chasing after him, and the big tree became his hope for survival. As long as he climbed up, he could save his life. The wolves bit his feet, so he took out his dagger and stabbed the wolves. The crisis was temporarily resolved. The wolves stayed under the tree all night and did not disperse until dawn, leaving only the injured gray wolf. Kodak used a dagger to make a spear. He originally wanted to kill the gray wolf, but after hearing the gray wolf's cry for help, Kodak relented. After all, he was a person who didn't even dare to kill a wild boar, so how could he kill a wild wolf? Seeing the dying gray wolf, Kodak decided to save him. The wolf lay motionless on the ground. The boy wanted to save him. The wolf bared its teeth. The boy was frightened and froze for a moment. He found a rope and put it against the wolf's mouth. Now he was safe. The boy picked up the wolf, went to the river to clean his wounds, and named the wolf Alpha. Suddenly, several hunting dogs not far away stared at them. Kodak quickly hugged Alpha and ran away. He escaped to a cave and could finally sleep well tonight. The next day, he picked some herbs and applied them to his injured foot. As soon as he took a drink of water, Alpha's voice came from beside him. Koda looked back and saw that Alpha had removed the rope from his mouth. Kodak suppressed his fear and wanted to pass the clear water over. The vigilant Alpha yelled at him. Kodak was frightened and froze again. He kept saying soothing words. Alpha seemed to understand his words and slowly spoke to Kodak. He put down his hostility and began to drink the water from the bowl. Kodak found some bugs to treat Alpha's wounds. The wolf was actually very well behaved at the moment. The next day, Kodak found a rabbit. In order to survive, he finally took action. Kodak returned to the cave to drill wood to make fire, but Alpha wanted to snatch the rabbit meat. Kodak slapped him with a backhand, and he bit off a piece of raw meat to show who was the boss. Alpha lay helplessly aside and did not dare to move. Kodak has obtained the spar. At night, he ate roast rabbit. Alpha looked at him and drooled. Kodak threw a few bones to him. Alpha ate with such relish that he had forgotten that he was a wolf. After a period of rest, Kodak and Alpha recovered from their injuries. He must return to the tribe before the heavy snow comes. Before leaving, he said goodbye to Alpha, but Alpha refused to leave. Kodak set out on his way home. Before he could go far, he found Alpha following him. No matter how hard he tried to drive him away, Alpha just didn't want to leave. Kodak used a wooden stick to drive him away, but Alpha actually took the wooden stick back. In this way, one person and one wolf started their journey home. With Alpha's company, the difficulty of hunting is greatly reduced. He can eat delicious barbecue every night, and their relationship gradually deepens. At night, as the bonfire goes out, Alpha will take the initiative to approach and use his body to warm Kodak. The scene looks extremely intimate. When he woke up in the morning, Alpha would keep licking him, but he was so smelly. Kodak took him to take a bath in the nearby river. They played happily in the river, and Alpha also caught a big fish. The friendship between one person and one wolf becomes deeper and deeper, as autumn turns to winter. The wilderness was covered with snow, and Kodak was enjoying delicious food at night. Alpha suddenly stood up and made a defensive posture. A group of wolves not far away stared at them, but Alpha made an astonishing move. The wolf king came over fiercely, and the man was stunned into silence. At this time, Alpha walked towards the wolf king. He said to the wolf king, "This is my eldest brother, please give me some face, and forget about it today." Unexpectedly, the wolf king actually left, but Alpha did not leave. He seemed to be asking Kodak for his opinion. Kodak knew very well that Alpha did not belong to him. Although Alpha was very reluctant to leave, he finally chose to leave. Kodak embarked on the journey home alone. Without Alpha's company, Kodak seemed very lonely. He continued to move towards home. Perhaps it was already destined. When passing through a piece of ice, Kodak discovered Alpha not far away. He ran towards Alpha excitedly, but danger also approached quietly. The ice suddenly broke and he fell into the cold river water. The undercurrent rushed him far away, and he could not find the exit. When he was about to drown, Alpha appeared. He shaved ice on it and then jumped. He wanted to break through the ice, but his weight was not enough. At the critical moment, Kodak took out the dagger in his arms and struck several times, finally cutting through the ice. Alpha hurriedly bit his sleeve, and Kodak was out of danger. At temperatures of dozens of degrees below zero, he was shivering with cold, and Alpha kept licking his face. Kodak took off his frozen clothes and hugged Alpha with his back against the campfire to keep warm, but he still caught a cold. Alpha did not leave this time and decided to escort Kodak home. The weather became worse and worse, and suddenly several hunting dogs appeared in front of them. Alpha and Kodak ran all the way, with the hunting dogs chasing after them. He and Alpha got into a cave, thinking they had gained short-term safety, but they didn't know there was something inside the cave. More powerful creatures. Alpha made an attack move, and a black panther slowly appeared. He rushed towards Kodak. In order to protect him, Alpha rushed forward without fear. But its size was no match for the black panther, and it bit him crazily. Kodak took aim with his bow and arrow, and then shot the black panther to death with one arrow. After the battle, Alpha stood up. After seeing Kodak safe, he could no longer hold on and fell to the ground. This time Kodak regarded him as one of his own tribesmen and vowed to take him back to the tribe no matter what. They move on. Koda discovered the stones piled up by the tribesmen, pushed aside the snow, and found the marks on them, which meant that he was not far from home. The snowstorm is getting worse and worse. Alpha is seriously injured. Every step he takes is very difficult. His body has reached its limit. Before he had gone far, Alpha fell to the ground. Looking at the old man fighting side by side, he really couldn't survive this time. Kodak picked him up and would not throw him away whether he was alive or dead. After countless days and nights and many snow-capped mountains, Kodak finally saw the tribe with his amazing willpower. But Alpha didn't know whether to live or die. He dragged his exhausted body back to his hometown, and even his father couldn't believe it. Kodak pointed in the direction of Alpha and begged his father to save Alpha. When he woke up, the first thing he did was to look for Alpha. Alpha was still dying. With the help of the witch, Alpha actually gave birth to a litter of wolf babies. It turned out that during this journey home, Alpha had been pregnant, and the tribesmen were deeply moved. Soon after, Alpha returned to normal, and a litter of wolf babies grew up and became part of the tribe. In the days that followed, everyone in the tribe was accompanied by wolves. After a long time, their descendants evolved into another creature named Wolf Dog. Although the story is thin, it vividly demonstrates the friendship between humans and animals. If you also have a pet, please be kind to it.